Children with autism are waiting too long to be diagnosed. That's according to a report which was released by the Australian Medical Association today. The organisation is also calling for a national policy around early intervention. Public health advocate and former AMA president, Professor Brian Owler, was at the launch today. He joins me now. Professor Owler, always great to see you. Thanks so much for dropping in. Why the delays in diagnosis?
Well, that's a good question. I think there have been changes in how we actually diagnose autism. We know that there are many more diagnoses being made, but I think people don't understand the conditions. They don't know the signs to look for, and that applies sometimes to doctors and paediatricians as well.
So when you say people, parents potentially, carers, sisters, brothers, and then when you shift your child off to a GP, they're not quite sure what's going on either.
Yeah, and there's often the tendency to want to wait a little bit more time before you actually make the diagnosis. But what we do know is that you can see the signs before 12 months of age, at 18 months of age, and certainly by 2 years of age, many children show the classic signs of autism. And it's not until the diagnosis is made and people understand the condition and look back that they can actually see all of those traits that actually go into making the diagnosis.
So what are the classic signs then?
Well, it's a neurodevelopmental condition, and a lot of it has to do with sensory processing.
Yep.
So there are delays sometimes in terms of speech, inattention. So when the child is spoken to, they often don't turn their attention away from the activity that they're doing. They can display repetitive or compulsive behaviours, but also be very sensitive to sounds. So often things like loud sounds, machinery that might be used, or a bang that might go off in the kitchen can sometimes cause considerable distress to a child. Likewise, clothing and things that the child might normally just wear can actually feel quite uncomfortable for the child. So it's about a lot of their sensory processing and understanding and processing the world around them.
In terms of the sensory processing, are there any other conditions, diseases, which kind of have similar symptoms where autism could be not diagnosed and something else diagnosed in its place?
Well, certainly some of the behavioural aspects can be a reflection of other types of conditions, and sometimes it's more felt to be that the child might be developing normally but maybe just lagging behind their peers, because we know development is a spectrum. But when those signs are coming together, it's usually very clear that the diagnosis is going to be somewhere on the spectrum of autism spectrum disorder. And of course, that allows people to actually understand their child and what's actually happening with them, but also institute the therapies which are very important if you're going to get the best outcome for that child.
I was going to get to that. So if a diagnosis is late, for example, someone diagnosed in their late teens but has gone through all their school life and adolescence undiagnosed, how much does that set them back?
Well, it's a missed opportunity, and
yep.
It's never too late to make a diagnosis and to institute therapy. And many of those children have had some form of therapy. But when it is known that it is on the spectrum of autism or an autism spectrum disorder, the appropriate therapies can be instituted. And that's often things like speech pathology, occupational therapy, but also behavioural therapy as well. And these are very intensive and often time-consuming, resource-intensive therapies, but that is known to give the best outcome for the child, and the earlier that's instituted, the better.
The AMA is also calling for this national policy around early intervention. Do you have a sense of what this national policy might look like?
Well, we know that guidelines are being developed as we speak. There's a project underway based in Western Australia that's actually looking at guidelines. And I think that's what we need, because the nature of the diagnosis, its very definition, has actually changed over time. So years ago when I went through medical school, we never learnt about autism.
Right.
But we need to actually educate and empower the GPs and paediatricians, many of whom are doing a fantastic job as it is. But we know that things change over time, and this is about trying to give them the right resources, training and support so that the children and their parents can get the best outcomes.
Professor Brian Owler, always such a pleasure to see you, and thanks so much for dropping in.
Thank you.
Thank you.